ask you this morning, if you'll open your Bibles with me, if you have a Bible with you, to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. I'm going to begin in verse 1, and then I'm going to skip down to verse 14. And then we're going to come back and pick up the middle section. Can we do that? Beginning with verse 1, and I'm reading from the New American Standard version today. It is a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, it is a fine work that he desires to do. Now skip to verse 14. I am writing these things to you, hoping to come to you before long. But in case I am delayed, I write so that you may know how one ought to conduct himself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the support of truth. And by common confession, great is the mystery of godliness. He was revealed in the flesh. He was vindicated in the spirit, beheld by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, and taken up to glory. As we look at this text, we see the awesome responsibility of being an overseer or a pastor. And we see at the end of this chapter God's view and a description of the church. And notice how possessive the definition that Paul writes about the church is in verse 15 and 16. He says, in case I'm delayed, I write this so that you may know how one ought to conduct himself in the household of God. The household of God. The church is God's household. I think it's interesting when people take exchange students. I think it's interesting for me when I travel, I'd rather not stay in a hotel. I'd rather stay in a household because you get to know people. And when you're traveling in a different culture, you get to know the culture more staying in a household as you observe the local household cultures. You eat their food, you listen to their discussions, you watch how a household lives out under its values. And we are defined as the household of God, as if God was saying, this is my household. These are the people who have come under my roof and under my care. And this is how it works in this household. There are many households in the world. There's many different groupings of people who are kind of, you know, magnetically drawn together. But the household of God is under the rule of Jesus Christ. It's the household of God. And notice what it says, which is the church of the living God. When you're under the household of God and you're seeing yourself as God who is living in community with you, life looks a whole lot different. And so it is as we define the leadership role, we see the importance of the leadership role because there is always some sort of government in the household of God. There is authority. There is the ruling of God as he passes down through his body. And so there are these important things for the church to understand if it's going to be a living example of God living among people. First of all, it's the household of God. And that one of the definitions that I like about the household of God is much like we see in the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 31, I believe it is, God told them as they built the temple that he was specifically gifting this one guy. I can't say his name, but it starts with a B. And he says, I'm going to gift this guy, and the Holy Spirit's going to come on him, and he's going to have special abilities beyond his own abilities to build the house of God. He's going to have craftsmanship of silver and gold and weaving of goat hair and gold strands and golden loops and building the altar, he's going to have something above himself that he's going to use in building this visible tabernacle. And so it is, I believe, in the church of God, there are people who God raises up who are sort of filled with the Holy Spirit above themselves to bring about the gathering together of God's household and the care given within the household of God. And these guys in the Old Testament temple were filled with the Holy Spirit to accomplish something that God wanted to do. Now we realize that, you know, God is not limited to you and me. God can do things beyond us, and that's a good thing because I love it when I watch God work in the life of an individual, and he's working so much beyond the context that that person may have with other believers. But God typically uses other believers in that process. And so when we begin to see who we are in God's perspective, life begins to be lived out differently in your life, in my life. I think one of the best definitions given to us is 1 Peter chapter 2. And in 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter's writing about the temple of God, and he's writing about the church of God, and he's comparing the church to the Old Testament temple. And we realize that after Pentecost, you know, Stephen stands up and he says this wonderful history of the Jewish people, and he says, they about stone him at this point, but he said, God doesn't live in temples made of stone, but he lives in the hearts of flesh and blood. And it's his body that he's raising up, and we understand this. And whoa, this was such a new concept that they stoned him. And that started a persecution, and it took the gospel to the Gentiles from that point on. And so something happened. But Peter and the apostles began to realize that the real building of God, the New Jerusalem, the city whose architect and builder is God, that Abraham was promised, that I'm going to show you, Abraham, you follow me, I'm going to show you a temple whose builder and architect is God. It's going to have God's fingerprints on it. It's going to look like God built it, not man. And so even with the best people filled with the Holy Spirit, building the magnificent temple that was in Jesus' day, it still is destroyed. And to this day, there's just a mound up there, and God is saying, look, don't focus on a building because buildings can come and buildings can go. And it's fun for me sometimes to bring people through. I have a group of pastors that are usually passing through to see the business and ministry model, the training model, or the multi-site model that we're doing. And we had a pastor here last week, and he's looking at the coffee bar, and we had some people come from out, I guess, on the west side of the state of Indiana somewhere, and they came, and they're kind of shocked because they see the coffee bar, and they come in here, and they say, wow, there's no carpet on the floor, and what are these towels doing in the chairs? Well, you know, and some people come in, the first thing they think is, well, I guess this is an emotional church. And so people cry and they have to have these towels or something, you know. Or maybe they think, you know, that's when the women prophesy. They put that towel on their head or something weird, you know. It depends upon what your perspective is and what background you come from to the scores of things that I've asked people, what do you think those towels are for? And then I tell them, no, it's when you spill a latte. And that this place is steel and glass and some metal and concrete. And this building that we are meeting in is not sacred. It's been dedicated to God, yes, for his purpose, yes. And we want it to be used for that. But honestly, this building will someday collapse. And something, an earthquake could take it down, a storm could take it out. And that's kind of what happened in Jesus' day. They put so much emphasis on the temple that he said, I'll tell you what, not one stone will be left on top of another. Because you've rejected the day of your visitation, God came and you didn't recognize it. So this temple that you put so much stock in, and the very thing that you're building your identity is going to be taken away. And the reason God did that is because he wanted them to focus on the city whose architect and building is God. And what does that look like? Well, I better get to it. It's 1 Peter chapter 2, where he says, and coming to him to be a living stone, rejected by men, but choice and precious in the sight of God. You also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. Okay? Through Jesus Christ. What is God saying about you? He's saying that, you know what? My investment, yeah, you got to have brick and mortar and iron and cement to meet in and keep warm when it's cold, especially in Indiana. But that's really not my focus. My focus is living stones. And each one of you are a stone that God is putting together. And it's really interesting because we talked about this just moments ago as we commissioned these people. They felt that God has spoken to their hearts and they are to give themselves to the local assembly of this expression here of what God is like, of people being put together like stones, but they're alive. And they're not located in one spot, they're highly mobile. But what God is doing in the midst of his called out group of people is amazing, because we are priests in this temple. And we offer up sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So you give yourself to God. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect. But as you give yourself to God, he works through you as a living stone. And he expresses who he is in this world so that they can see what God is like through what he does in his people. So this house is a house of God. It's the household of God. It's the pillar and the ground of truth. Folks, that's why it's so important for you and I to speak the truth. Sometimes I think we're tempted to just kind of be accepted and say whatever brings acceptance, and we don't have the concept of living for the audience of one. And sometimes we veer off just slightly from the truth, and we get off into things that are not backed by God. And if you want God's backing, you stay within the perimeters of God's truth. A few weeks ago, we showed you some well-known people who are off. You know, not 100% off, maybe 8% off, or on target. But the 8% will take you down a road that will throw us off course. And so we are these living stones, and God has commissioned us to live in the truth. Somebody sent me an email this week. And in the email, there were several quotes, and two of them were quite similar. And if you really want to get the quote, you could probably ask Wade, because Wade sent it to me. But this is what it said. Basically, it said, the darker the culture becomes, the more the truth becomes revolutionary. I was talking to a friend of mine who was raised up as a pastor in my first church, and he's been talking to me, and he was communicating with me that, you know, his heart is to follow God and follow his call as a pastor, and he's kind of wondering what to do, and he's talking it through with me, and I'm forgetting what I was going to say about that. But the truth, it's that the darker that the culture around us gets, the more revolutionary the truth becomes. And I think it's really neat. He was saying to me that, you know, I actually talked to some people last week, he said, that had no concept. Who is Jesus Christ? I've never heard of him. And, you know, to us in our culture, Jesus Christ is so, the concept is so known by most people that people even use it to take his name in vain. Just whatever. throw his name around like, you know, it's nothing. And we as believers hold that name in high regard. And, you know, you can say poopy, but don't say Jesus Christ in vain, because that's bad, you know. And there are people who do not even know who Jesus Christ is. Our culture is post-Christian. It's moving fast, and we're following Europe. You know, we're about 15, 20 years maybe behind Europe. And it's very post-Christian. Who is Jesus Christ? I don't know him. I'm not against him. I don't know who he is. Who is he? What do you know about this Jesus? And the more dark our culture becomes, people speaking the truth will become the revolutionaries of that culture. And folks, you and I have power when we speak the truth. We have power because God backs us. We are his mouthpiece. We're the household of God. We're the priesthood. You need to see yourself as one being given the pillar of truth. Now, pillar's an interesting word in the Old Testament. As you may recall, when God led his visible people that he was backing, he led them out of Egypt through miraculous signs and wonders. And then they crossed the sea, and the Pharaoh's army drowned in pursuit of them, and he set his people free, and God drew a line, and he says, now you're my people, you're no longer slaves of another country, you're my people, and you're under my household. And they go, great, now we're your household, but where are we? We're wandering around in tents in the middle of the desert where there's no water or food. And what did God say? Great, you're really going to know who I am now. Because your life is so dependent on me, I'm going to teach you who I am. At night, I'm going to be a what? A pillar of fire. In the daytime, when it's hot, guess what I'm going to be? A cloud in the desert. And a friend of mine once had got lost in the desert doing a photo shoot. And he got turned around. He didn't know where he was. And he did everything he could to survive. He took his spare tire. He got stuck in the sand. He took his spare tire and burned it so that someone might see, a plane or something might see black smoke billowing, and somebody might come and rescue him. He was running out of water. He ventured out for an hour and couldn't make it and had to go back to the shade of his the canopy on his truck. And he said he went and he asked God, I guess this is it. I guess I'm going to die and perish here in this desert. And so he prayed and he says, God, please help me. And he said a cloud came and over where he was, and it started moving. And as the shade moved, he moved, and it moved at his pace, and it led him to a house. I can tell you his name is Skip Moore, and it's a real story, and I know him personally. Can you imagine being so dependent on God that the pillar of fire and the cloud, what's God's household like? Well, it's a group of people living in dependency on God, so much so that if God abandons them, they're dead. They'll perish. Well, we have so many props around us that sometimes I think our dependency on God begins to weaken the more props we get around us. But that's how God revealed himself, and he says, this is who you are. You're my household. I'm going to live among you. My spirit is going to live in you. And the things that you used to be comfortable doing, you're going to feel convicted and miserable about, because I'm calling you to my purposes, and wherever I call you, there's going to be provision. And God caused water to come out of the rock in the desert. God caused manna to fall for food to sustain them. And when we are on mission with God and his presence is with us, his truth sustains us, we become pillars of the truth in a culture that is so crooked and so weak. And so we are people that speak the truth. And the darker the world, sometimes I think Christians are intimidated and they back off of the truth because culture is so evil. It's like, let's just abandon the culture. No. Engage the culture. Why? Because God's not afraid of the darkness. His light penetrates the darkness. He's called you to be on mission, to live a life in dependency on God, that the world may see what God is like through weak people who don't have it together, who gripe and complain like the children of Israel, but God stands with them and corrects them and brings them into his purpose. This is the church of the living God that Jesus shed his blood for and has called you into, that he made you a child of his. This is who you are. And that is why this is so important to understand the role of leadership within the church, because it's the church of Jesus Christ. It's the church of the living God and the pillar and the support of truth. Now, here's the pillar and support of truth put in words of a song. You know, we sing worship songs. I was asking Judy, who wrote that song there? I've never heard that. That's neat. Who wrote that song? She says, I don't know. I guess it doesn't matter, but we have songs in our worship service that reflect who we are and who God is and who he's calling us to be. And those songs are good for us to sing because it's corporate worship. We're speaking the truth, you see, in these songs. And hopefully the songs that we choose are truthful, right? Okay, here's a song that Paul quotes to Timothy. And he's quoting like maybe one of his favorite worship songs. And this is basically a worship song in Paul's day. And by common confession, great is the mystery of godliness. What is real godliness? Great is the mystery of godliness. Here it is. What is godliness? He was revealed in the flesh. Jesus Christ was God, through virgin birth became a man and took on himself flesh so that he could see how you live. And God wrapped himself in flesh. And he can identify with your weakness. And we can see what God is like. He is the exact representation of the invisible God, it says in Hebrews. He was vindicated by the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit. He was vindicated by the Spirit. And all those who watched him be baptized heard a voice that said, "This is my Son in whom I am well pleased." And the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove. And Peter, James, and John, once up on the mountain of Transfiguration, heard these words as Peter was saying, "Hey, let's build three temples, one for you, one for Elijah, and one for Moses." And God says, "No, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased." And a cloud came over them, the Shekinah of glory, the same cloud probably that led them in the wilderness, came over them. And Jesus was vindicated to be God's own Son. And then we have, not only was he revealed in the flesh, vindicated in the Spirit, he was beheld by angels. Angels longed to look at why God would want to come as a little baby into a world, into his own creation. The angels longed to look, even unto your salvation. Whoa, you mean God wants that person and that person? Yes, absolutely. And the angels are our messengers, they're servants of those who receive eternal life. And they long to look into this. And when Jesus died and he was buried, it said that he went into the recesses of the earth. Just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so must the Son of Man be 3 nights and 3 days in the center of the earth. And it says that he preached, Peter says he preached to the spirits below. So angels long to understand who this Jesus is. He was believed on in the world. You have believed on Jesus, and it has stuck. This gospel is being lived out over and over and over by those who have put their faith and trust and believed in him. God is really vindicated by you and your salvation. Because you believe, he comes, he dwells with you. And what's it like to have the living God in your life? He stands with you in the truth. And he was taken up and he ascended into heaven. He said this, "Don't be shocked that I go. Don't let your hearts be troubled. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I'm going to come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And it's to your advantage that I go, because if I go, I'll ask the Father to send the Helper, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit to guide you." And so he ascended into heaven. And one of the greatest joys, I think, that I get to understand and preach is the ascension of Christ presents the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the workings of God as he indwells the lives of individual believers, as we are these living stones being put together. Now, what is, that's a New Testament concept of the church. Now, what is the New Testament concept of a pastor? Look at verse 1. It is a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, it is a fine work he desires to do. What is it like for a New Testament pastor? There are two Greek words used somewhat interchangeably for pastor or overseer or bishop or presbyter. And it is this word, presbytos, which we get our word presbyter, which I believe the Presbyterians get their word for how they function. And that is the word for elder. And an elder in the Old Testament was somebody who was Dura of a Buick. They were older. Just joking. Actually, some Ball State students gave me some pictures of Buicks and in a card. And they picked real classic and real futuristic ones. And I would drive any one of those Buicks, actually. Just to let you know, I'm just joking about the Buick thing. But most of you have noticed that when you're being held up, it's not surprising if it is a Buick, a mommy van, or a Grand Marquis, right? Okay. You all have confessed that to me and said, you know, I never noticed that until you started talking about it. But now I really get it. It's true. But once in a while, I'll be passed by a Buick, and I always smile. I think, all right, there's one that's out of the box. I love that, you know. Being passed by a Buick is a really smile on my day, you know. And so you who drive Buicks, go change the concept of people who drive Buicks. The pedal's on the right, floor that sucker. It really goes fast. Just go out and change our concept. Change my concept. Prove me wrong, okay? All right. An Old Testament elder was somebody who was a ruler of a tribe or a city or the nation. In the New Testament time, during the Gospels, they were primarily, elders were considered the Sanhedrin. It was a body of older, more mature men who made up the oversight of the Jewish worship and actually political as well. Now, there is another Greek word, which is episkopos, which is where we get our word Episcopalian, I suppose. And that word means and replies more of what a pastor does. He oversees. He's a bishop. He's a teaching pastor, perhaps. This is my Greek word studies this week. The elder describes more of his character and his maturity, who an elder is, where the other Greek word describes more of what a pastor does. And so let's look at what a pastor does. I'm going to ask you to go on a little bit of a journey with me and go back to the book of Acts, chapter 20. Will you go to Acts chapter 20 with me? Because I think we can understand this a little more clear as we see it really lived out in an example in the early church in Acts chapter 20. Look with me at verse 17. And I wish I had time because to do this whole, read this whole thing, it's really one of my favorite texts to preach and teach on. But in 17, and from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus. And where is Timothy located when Paul writes this? He says, stay on at Ephesus. Teach certain men not to teach false doctrine. And don't neglect your gifts. Stand up there and take the leadership of this church. And from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called to him the elders of the church. Now, elders in this case is used a different Greek word than he's going to use in verse 28. Now look at verse 28. Same guys, he's talking to the same guys. Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among you, which the Holy Spirit made you, what? Overseers. There's the other Greek word. And he's calling them elders here. and bishop overseer here. And so he says, this is be on your guard for yourself and to all the flock. Now, what does a pastor do? If an elder describes his spiritual maturity, then what does the other Greek word imply that he does? He oversees. He's a bishop. He takes care of oversight of the church. And what does Paul tell them to do here? As elders, to what? That God has made you overseers. You oversee. You oversee the affairs of the church. To shepherd the church. You're to shepherd the people in the church. You're to shepherd the flock as a group, as it goes forth into its culture. That you shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. Folks, it's not my church. It's his church. It's not your church. It's his church. God has chosen to, by his Spirit, to make some people overseers. We don't make ourselves overseers. We're made by God's Spirit to be an overseer of the church. And he says, now I know that after I leave, ravenous wolves will come in among you, even among yourselves. And he's warning them about looking out for these people who are going to take the church in the wrong direction. He says, but I'm calling you. I'm charging you. By the Holy Spirit who made you an overseer, stand up and shepherd the church of God and oversee the work of God among you. And be careful, because after I leave, things are going to change fast. So, the function of a bishop or overseer is to oversee or feed the church or teach. One other verse I'd like to really have you read, and Chris came up with this in the teaching poll, and that is Colossians chapter 2. And this really goes back to, like, who are the Gentiles and what's this great mystery of God living among people? What is this? And Colossians 2 really nails it and then describes to us what the role of the pastor is. And there in chapter 2, or actually it's chapter 1, I'm sorry, chapter 1 verse 27. To whom God will made known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among Gentiles. What is this mystery? Which is Christ in you. Do you realize when you come to faith in Christ, Christ comes and he indwells you. He lives in you. Christ in you makes you a believer. Now, once Christ is in you, you have new potential, new power to be on course with what God. You were once dead in your trespasses and sins. You walked according to the course of this world. But now this mystery has been made known that Christ will actually come and live in you who open your hearts to him. And as he lives in you, you will be changed from the inside out. This isn't some dead religion. It's the church of the living God living in people. And when Christ comes and lives in you, there's a change that happens that you cannot do yourself. It's a change from the inside out. Some of it is instantaneous and some of it is ongoing struggles. How many of you know what I mean when I say instant? How many of you know what I mean when I say ongoing struggles? But Christ in us changes us from the inside out. And here it is, verse 28. And we proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, that we may present every man complete in Christ. One of the best, funnest, coolest jobs, and I know my English isn't that good, but I'll say funnest anyway because it's so fun to say. But one of the great pleasures that I feel of God is when you teach the word and people start getting it. They believe it. And their life starts in this transformation curve that's just fun to watch. And I just love that because what our job is to present Jesus who comes and lives in us. And if Christ is in us, you're fun to teach. Because the things that I say that are of God, they're going to resonate within you because God's in there saying, yeah, that's right. This is who you are. And I know it looks like this. We were praying over someone, I don't even remember who, that it happens so often, sometimes I don't remember who is praying for who, and it's just as well. We were praying for someone, and someone saw this picture of a brick wall. It looked like a brick wall, but it was paper. It was painted brick, you know, like a set on a movie or a set on a stage. And this person was looking at it like they couldn't break through. But it was an illusion. And once they understood the material it was made of, it changed their perspective, you know. That the goal was to change their perspective so they could break through it. And I think that that's a lot of what we do. Christ has done so much for us, and when the Holy Spirit comes and lives in us, the pleasure we get to do is say, hey, that's just paper. You can bust it through. Do it like, you know, when they come out on the football field, and they have the thing, and they break through the paper. I always wanted to be the one who got to do that. You know, I never did, but it looks cool, doesn't it? Wouldn't you always want to break through, and everybody cheers, and it's like, oh, yeah, what did I do? Wow, I broke through paper. Like I really did something, right? What I'm saying is this. The job that the pastor gets to do is to speak the word, the gospel of truth, and watch people break through paper all day long. And I never get tired of it. That every man that would be presented complete, that every man will break through their paper painted brick wall. You know? That each one of us, there's things that God is calling you to do, and he's inside of you, and he's saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you go, no, it's impossible, it's brick. And I say, no, that's just paper. Charge. You go, it is? And you break through. And suddenly you see yourself differently than you saw yourself before. And the goal and the job that I get and the times that I feel the most pleasure from God is when people get who God has made them to be. God has already done it, but we don't get it. We're slow, aren't we? We're slow. And that's why God put me up here, because I'm slow. And you say, and people say, well, Pastor, I like when you preach because you relate to like a sixth grader. And I go, well, thanks. I really appreciate that. But I love to tell people that the wall is just painted paper. It's really not brick. And I want to speak into your lives. And I love it sometimes when I get to pray over people and I get heavenly perspective and people see themselves from God's perspective instead of the limitations that they put on themselves, and they move into a completeness of what God has created them to be. And that is where it's at for me. I love it. Absolutely love it. And I've watched it happen over and over and over again. And I never get tired of it. Never get tired of it. Now, one of the things that kind of gets me about this passage that I didn't like. Can I tell you what I didn't like about chapter 3, verse 1? I didn't like the idea, and I want to talk to you about this because I don't like it, but I understand it now. And usually if I don't like the word, it's me that needs to, well, not usually. All the time. Where is 1 Timothy? Oh, here it is. It is a trustworthy statement if any man aspires or desires the office of overseer, it's a fine work he desires to do. I don't really like that because it's like, that's just saying like, if you get the desire, you can be a pastor. It's like, I thought it was a calling, you know? In our internship, we interview people, and we want to hear that word called. You know, I have a sense of calling. Maybe I don't know what it is, or I'm called to be a pastor. I'm called to be a missionary, and we want that sense of calling to be there. And then we were talking to Mark via the internet. We conference with Mark in Ireland on Wednesdays, and so if you ever want to say hi to Mark, just come by about 10 o'clock on Wednesdays, and he's up on the big screen in the glass room there. And you can say hi to Mark. And Mark was on there this week. And I said, Mark, I don't like this. Tell us how it was like when you came into the internship. Because you told us, I kind of feel called maybe to be a worship leader. But I said, when you left, he said, you're now pastoring. And not only are you pastoring, but you're pastoring as a missionary in Ireland. How did that happen? Give me the progression of this, you know, from sense of call to actually being, you know, commissioned to be a pastor in our. Give me that process that you are working through, you know, and I know my process, but give me your process. And he said, you know, I think the calling was there, but it wasn't until I was willing to embrace it and I desired it. The calling was there before I desired it, but there was a period of time when God was stirring me and he was calling me, yet I was not answering that call and desiring to follow him. And so during that period of time, God worked in his heart, and it fleshed out within this two-year period of time that he was in the internship. And he struggled with that sense of call, thinking, you know, and I did too. I thought, well, you know, I'll be a campus worker, or I'll do a coffee house in the 70s. You know, it wasn't good coffee back, like, you know, back then like it is now. But maybe I could work in a coffee house and work with street people, because I could never wear wingtips and, you know, shiny suits. And so I thought, this is not me. And in the process, it wasn't that I wasn't called. It was that there was a period of time that I resisted that call to be a pastor. And God kind of tricked me into it, and now I love it. But I candidated just because I got to preach more, and then they wanted me. And then I go, oh, no, now I'm a pastor. What does a pastor do? I don't know. I guess I preach Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesdays, and visit people when they go to the hospital. I guess that's what a pastor does, and that's where I started. And there was a period of time when God was stirring and calling, but I was not desiring it. But when you get to the place of you're stirred and called and you're now desiring it, then this transition begins to happen. And Timothy's told, now look out for people who have this sense of call that are answering that call and they actually desire to be an overseer. And I believe that the calling is important. Timothy, you know, he's one himself. It's like, Timothy, don't neglect your gifts. Stay on at Ephesus. I know you want to leave, but stay on there. And remember the prophecies that were previously prayed over you, Timothy, that you by them you fight the fight of faith. Remember, Timothy, you were singled out to be a pastor. And now that you're answering that call, fight the fight according to that perspective that came to you when God spoke to you about being a pastor. And then, now that you've accepted that, then he was then appointed. Now, I want to go to two quick scriptures, and then we're going to wind up the last part really, really fast. The first scripture we want to look at is Acts chapter 14. And I love, this really spells it out for us so that we can get it without a lot of questions. Once you're called and once you are desirous of being a pastor, then it's helpful if other people recognize it with you that are leaders. There are people who I have met in my life who come up to me and they hand me a card that they're a pastor or they're a prophet or they're an apostle. And I go, well, where's your group? And they go, well, I don't have one. It's like, well, then you're not functioning as one. Maybe you're in dreamland. Or maybe there's some real call to you, but I don't know why you've printed up a card and done that first. But here's how it was done in the New Testament. Acts chapter 14, verse number 23. And when they had appointed elders in every church, having prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord to whom they had believed. Once you are desirous, it's good to have that calling and stirring recognized by people who God has put in authority. And so what did they do? They went back through and they laid hands on, they ordained, they commissioned, or they appointed pastors in every city. It's the same thing in Titus, and we'll get there in Titus 1:5, where Paul writes Titus and he says, appoint pastors in every city. Folks, I think the pastor that we understand today is different than the elder of the Old Testament. It's more organic. It's more God stirring and raising up. When Paul spoke to the Ephesian pastors, he said, give yourself to overseeing the flock whom the Holy Spirit has made you an overseer. The Holy Spirit calls and stirs and raises up. And so Paul was the first one to really move away from the Jewish mindset of the synagogue and older guys. And actually, how old is Timothy? He's pretty young. Don't let people despise your youth, Timothy. But now he begins to realize that it's more organic. God calls people, they desire it, and having observed that person, there is a great discernment through prayer and sometimes fasting before hands are laid on and before commissioning is done in the New Testament, and people were actually ordained or appointed as a pastor among the people. Okay? And so I believe there's this more organic thing. And I can't make anybody. I can put my hands on people, but that isn't going to make them a pastor. But when God is stirring that person and I recognize it, and God gives me his perspective, then great things happen. And most of the site pastors, all of the site pastors actually, have been appointed by myself over that church. And the district superintendent says, Guy, we want you to appoint the guys in this movement. And we believe that you're supposed to do that. And so they bless that, and we do that sort of thing. And it's really been neat to watch, because I can't make anybody a pastor, but people who have that and who give themselves to that, then we can put our hands on and bless them and commission them, just like in the New Testament. You know, I like the word overseer better than elder. I like it better than bishop and presbyter. I like overseer because it defines something that you do. You are an overseer because you oversee. And guess what? We have more of an organic nature around here. So if you are leading a home group and you're overseeing a home group, if you're overseeing, say, the youth group, if you're overseeing an outreach, guess what? You are an overseer. What makes you an overseer? God calls you, stirs you, you do it, and people recognize it, and they want to follow you. And if they don't, and you aren't, then you're no longer an overseer because nobody shows up. Isn't this simple? And I like this because in the qualifications on deacons, it says, let them first be tested, and once they're proven, then put your hands on them. And so you can test. You can watch who God's stirring, raising up, who's following, if they have a heart for God, and then you put your hands on and you bless. Now, I'm going to blitz through because these are self-explanatory. I just want to read the qualifications and tell you, first of all, that as I read these, I get squeamish because I'm not this sometimes. An overseer then must be above reproach. It means nothing that can be charged against them will stick. The husband of one wife. You shouldn't have five wives. Like, you know, David had, I don't know how many David had. I think his son Solomon 20 upped him or something. But one wife, and I believe it means at a time, husband of one wife, and temperate, prudent, respectable, hospitable, and able to teach. And this is kind of not addicted to wine, if he drinks, or pugnacious but gentle, uncontentious, free from the love of money. One thing that you want a pastor to be is not too far out there where he's trying to drive the work of God, but he has a gentle spirit, giving place for the Holy Spirit to stir and lead other people. Not addicted to wine, one who is uncontentious and gentle and free from the love of money. Folks, I get so sick of TV preachers manipulating people out of the money. I get so tired of that. I hope you do too. Do you hate that? Please hate that. Do you hate that? Good. Because if you love money, then it's a real downfall. The love of money is the roots of all kinds of evil. And then we have his qualifications for his family is that he must be one who manages his own household well. And it may mean household may mean you have servants and uncles and dads and moms and how you relate there. Gosh, I'm glad we're not doing that today. I would hate to manage a bigger household than what I have. but manages his own household while keeping his children under control with dignity. But if a man does not know how to manage his own household, how will he take care of the church of God? And not a new convert, lest he become conceited and full and fall into condemnation incurred by the devil. You don't want a new believer who's going to start feeling so good about himself that he gets arrogant, because that's how the devil fell, and pride can be an issue. Notice the temptations he's put out there so far. He talks about addiction to wine, he talks about money, and he talks about pride. These are really issues where it's important not to fall. Not a new convert. He must have a good reputation with those outside the church, so that the church may not, that he may not fall into a reproach and the snare of the devil. Then it goes into deacons. Now, pastors oversee and teach, and they oversee the spiritual needs of the people. The deacons care for more of the physical needs, and deacon means servant. And so we have servants in the church. They must, in the same way, like manner, meaning the same kind of qualifications, dignity, not double tongue, not saying, oh yeah, I'm with you on that one, pastor, and then, oh yeah, I don't know why he's like that, but yeah, I'm with you on that, and I don't know why he's like that. That's double tongue. Don't have deacons like that. Now, in some churches, deacons are the people who run the church, if you're from the more Baptist persuasion, and the deacons kind of run the pastor sometimes. And how many are familiar with that style of government? Yeah. I thought it was funny when the one guy said, you know, well, I won't go there. I better not. That's a pastor's joke, and you wouldn't like it. So, not double-tongued or addicted to much wine. I guess they can drink a little more, but don't be addicted to much. That's just a joke. Or fond of sordid gain. You know, don't use this to make money for yourself. Holding to the mystery of faith with a clear conscience. One of the things you really want in leaders of the church is holding to a mystery of faith. And I think that sometimes God is leading us and it looks impossible, and it's when faith comes in. You know, but if God's in charge, we'll move forward to do this. That's the kind of people you want in leadership, because they have to hear God against the circumstances, right? And let them first be tested, and let them serve as deacons if they are beyond reproach. Women likewise must be dignified, not malicious gossips. So we have women leaders in the church now. Women don't gossip. I heard one guy said, man, I'd rather have a church full of smokers than a church full of gossipers. Amen on that one. Temperate, faithful, and did you think that was funny? Temperate and faithful in all things. Let deacons be husbands of only one wife, a good manager of their children and their own household. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a high standing and great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. I'm writing these things hoping to come to you, but in case I don't, he says, I want to give you these instructions so that you might know how to live together in God's, under God's roof, in the world in which we live. So I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. And I pray today that you can see yourself the way God sees you, and that you can stand up in the truth and not be intimidated by the darkness. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you would fall upon us to live out our faith in your presence and your power. You know, as I'm praying, I just have this image in my head. It's like we really need faith and power to take back what God wants in our community. And I don't know what this means, but I just sense this people grabbing a hold of who God is and who they are and taking it out in some new way that God can show himself to our community. I don't know what that's like, but Father, I pray for those right now who this little picture is resonating within their hearts. I pray, Father, that you would fall upon us. Give us eyes to see our community the way that you see it. Lord, let us see what only looks solid but is paper that we can crash through. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.